Well, thank you folks for attending today. Welcome to Grace. I want to invite you to return with me to the book of Romans. We've called it Paul's Handbook on Faith, where we're examining the first cornerstone in the foundation of every believer's faith, or faith rather. We call it the first cornerstone because Romans is laid out in four sections. I call them cornerstones. We've said on several occasions that Romans answers some very basic questions for us in those three cornerstones, as they were designed to answer these questions when it comes to such issues as why we need to have faith, what we're to place our faith in, what has been accomplished for us through Christ at Calvary, and what happened to God's program with Israel in light of the fact that there's a new dispensation and that Paul's been given instructions to bring to the Gentiles. Romans is an exciting book, probably one of the most exciting books, from my opinion, in that it was designed to be the foundational study in the doctrines concerning faith in the age of grace. So let's just take a moment before we dig into Romans chapter 3 and look at Paul's goal as an apostle. Paul states the purpose of his apostleship in the book of Colossians chapter 2, where he talks about his desire, as he said, to present every man perfect. That word perfect meaning mature in Christ Jesus, grown up. Paul went on then to explain that purpose in Colossians 2:2-3, where he said that their hearts might be comforted, being knit together in love, and unto all the riches, and here it is, all the riches of the full assurance of understanding, to the acknowledgment of the mystery of God and of the Father and of Christ, in whom are hid all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. Now, if we want to be grown up in our faith, mature believers, properly prepared for the judgment seat of Christ, we must come to a full assurance of understanding and our acknowledgment of the mystery of God. And the book designed to begin that growth process is none other than the book of Romans. So we're in a good spot right now. And this is where the edification, or what we call the building up process, begins to take root in the heart of the one who desires to be that mature believer that Paul just talked about. One of the first things our apostle wants us to come to a full assurance of understanding in is our need for faith. The truth of this first cornerstone here is the one that's called justification. I like to think of that term in the sense of righteousification, or our need to be righteousified. Why do we need to be justified or righteousified in the first place? Well, if you've been following along in these studies, you already know the answer. You know that Paul's been showing us here in the beginning chapters of Romans that we need to be justified, or as I said, righteousified, because our own performance, our own production, even when accompanied by our most sincere promises and pledges to God, is insufficient to accomplish for us a just standing in the eyes of a perfectly just God. It's as simple as that. Paul wants us first and foremost to come to a full assurance of understanding that when judged according to truth, we're all in the same boat. Each and every one of us, we had a need for a justification to be provided for us, a justification that would come totally apart from anything we could merit through our own performance. You see, the pride nature rebels against that truth. The pride nature hates to accept that truth. We don't want to see ourselves as unjust. We resist seeing ourselves as unjust. And actually, in the same boat, when we think about it, with those poor, unfortunate souls out there, we consider to be less just than we are. And, you know, this strikes right at the heart of the pride nature of man here. We try so much harder than some, do we not? I'm being facetious. But we try so much harder. We're much more religious than many folks. Certainly, our inner motives are more honorable than many out there. Why we dress better, we talk cleaner. We have far less obvious sins than others with whom we're familiar. Certainly, we are better in the eyes of Almighty God than some people. Are we not? Well, prideful human nature convinces us that we possess some righteousness, some meritorious standing before God of our own doing, some goodness achieved by our own accomplishments. And so what if we don't appear to have it right this very moment? We're certainly capable of achieving rightness if ever and whenever we desire to apply ourselves. Well, Paul's just set out to prove us wrong with that type of thinking. Paul set out to prove to mankind that nothing we do and nothing we promise to do will have anything whatsoever to do with our righteous standing before a perfectly righteous God. If God is to consider us just, it will have to be a justification found outside of us. Put simply, we'll have to be credited with a righteousness that comes totally apart from anything we do. This is what Paul set out to prove here in the early going of this first cornerstone called justification. And it's to convince man of his own injustice when compared to God's perfect justice. We're comparing righteousness, the righteousness of mankind, with God's very own righteousness. That's why we come short. Paul began by proving the Gentiles to be worthy of the wrath of God, not worthy of the reward. Ignorance is no excuse. A relative righteousness, no excuse when it comes to be counted wrath-worthy. Those defense pleas will do man no good. Paul's already proven it. God gave the Gentiles over, we learned in the early going, to their reprobate thinking, because the Gentiles did not want to retain God in their thoughts. They knew about him. The Bible clearly says they knew about him. Paul tells us they knew about him, but they wanted to do away with him in their minds. They wanted to refuse to acknowledge that he even existed. They became vain in their imaginations, as Paul put it. They began to worship idols of their own making rather than God himself. And the result of all that unbelief, well, God gave up working with the nations, plural, according to the Apostle Paul, and God began to deal with a chosen nation, that chosen people, that earthly program, those who would come from the loins of Abram, a chosen people that would become known as the nation Israel. God gave up on the Gentiles because God considered the Gentiles to be wrath-worthy, and the offspring of Abraham, with no little pride of their own, by the way, we're going to find out, would fully agree with what God did when he gave the Gentiles over to the reprobate thinking. But then Paul went on to prove that the self-righteousness of the Jew would be of no more use to the Jew than the self-righteous pleas of the Gentiles before them. Being associated with Abraham, having Abraham as their father, having possessions of the rules or the law program, even practicing religion, which many of the Jews were faithful to do, would be insufficient to accomplish the Jew a righteous standing before God. Which brings us to our text today, Romans chapter 3, verses 9 through 20. Now, Paul's been using the analogy of a courtroom and a trial here to make his case against mankind. God is obviously the judge at this trial. The Apostle Paul's playing the part of the prosecuting attorney. In chapter 1, the Gentiles stood before the prosecution bench in the court of God's justice and watched Paul the prosecutor say, guilty, wrath-worthy. We Gentiles had to sit down and take our place. And we watched chapter 2 and the early parts of chapter 3 there as the Jews were stripped of all their self-defense pleas, their defense pleas thrown out of court in a manner of speaking. So we've come to a climax in the trial of mankind here. Now, Paul's conclusion in his examination of the Jew sits in Romans 3:9, where Paul says, what then? Meaning in light of everything he's just stated in his case against the Jews, are we Jews better than they, better than the Gentiles before us? That's the idea here. You see, Paul was a Jew himself. So Paul had to include himself at this point. Are we Jews better than the Gentiles who God gave over to the reprobate thinking? Notice his answer as he continues there in verse 9. No. In no wise, for we have before proved who? Both Jews and Gentiles, that they are all under sin. Even though the Jews had enjoyed an advantaged position, the ultimate conclusion is the Jews and the Gentiles are all under sin, and therefore wrath-worthy. Good question at this point in time would be, what does it mean to be under sin? Well, Paul's just proven the human race to be under it, so what does it mean to be under sin? Interesting, and I don't know if you've caught this before in your own studies, but up to this point, Paul's been revealing the unrighteousness and the ungodliness of all mankind, both Jew and Gentile. He spent two chapters and a portion of chapter 3 proving the wrathworthiness of all mankind. But Paul's used a word here for the very first time in the book of Romans, and it took him to chapter 3 to use that word. You realize that the entirety of Paul's letter thus far, in that letter, Paul's never used this word until now. This is the very first time in his prosecution of mankind that Paul uses the word sin. Is that not an interesting thing? I just find that interesting. I believe it's significant the apostle uses it here, and I'll show you why.